We used to talk about prosperity a lot when we first got here, because one of the issues we had was people weren't so prosperous, didn't have a prosperous mentality. So we had to teach the Word of God so that the church would know that there's prosperity in the Lord. Amen. Now, it comes in different ways. It doesn't look like the world's prosperity. You don't get a straight paycheck sometimes every week. What you get is a blessing that leads to this and leads to that. It's the way of God. It's called faith. You can't see it. Amen. One of the things that we had identified, the Holy Spirit had shown me, he said, you got people in your church don't really want to be prosperous. That's what he said. He said, you got church people that don't think it's good to be prosperous. They're praying like this. He woke me up in the night sometime. He said, your people are praying like this. Some of them, they're praying, Lord, just help us pay the bills. If we can just pay the bills and get to heaven, we'll be good. He said, teach them something differently. He said, because with them just being able to pay their bills, they're not worried about anyone else. He said, their attitude is an abomination to my glory, because my glory is huge. And their faith is so small, it caps what I want to do. Teach them to care about what I want and not just to pray about what they can believe. I'm trying to do great things. The Lord told me, he said, I'm trying to send missionaries. And it takes hundreds of thousands of dollars to prepare a mission field and get them over there and train them another language. And I got people praying, Lord, just give me $1,000 to be able to get by. He said, they'll never be able to bless anybody, Lee. Teach them something different. He does the same thing with healing. Why? Because he's trying to get us well enough that we can do something with somebody else. Come on now. You know, you got church people got so many problems in their life because they're led by the world and not the Word. They can't get anything straight. They cannot become a blessing, a permanent, smooth-flowing, continual blessing. But that's the devil. That's not God. God is peace. God is joy. God is provision. God is safety. Come on now. I'm not saying it's perfect. What I'm saying is the end result is what his word says. I'm not saying you won't be challenged. I'm not saying you won't be tested. I'm saying that by your faith you will come through. Enoch knew this. He caught a rhema of something. He believed it. Let me tell you something, guys. He literally left here without dying. Everybody in this room thinks you're going to die. I'm going to tell you something. I don't believe you have to. Elijah never died. Elijah pleased God. He was taken up in a whirlwind. Chariots of fire came. Chariots of fire, the ministers of God, the angels of God came. The only way Elisha could describe it was chariots of fire separated us, and he was taken up in a whirlwind into heaven. That's what the Bible says. Where are the people that can believe for that? These guys never had the Holy Ghost, not on the inside of them, and they had more faith in a nickel than we sometimes have in a lifetime. I'm not bringing you down. I'm trying to bring you up. God says, rise up. Rise up and become the church. Not people talking. A church walking out the truth. Amen. A church so filled with the Spirit, you don't have to work. You don't have to think. You don't have to do. It's in you. It's in you. I want you to, if you will, think about it with me. If you'd go to 2 Kings chapter 6. 2 Kings 6. We're going to talk about Elisha. Not Elijah. Elisha. You with me? Somebody say amen. Amen. Okay, so you are there then? Okay. Amen. What about verse 8? Verse 8. We're going to do a good bit of reading. And I know it's not tradition in the church today. I know it's tradition to point to like three verses and go out. But we are Word of God people. We are different. Amen. We read the Bible. We love the Bible. We eat the Word of God as our daily bread. And it produces in our lives. Amen. Then the king of Syria warred against Israel and took counsel with his servants, saying, in such and such a place shall be my camp. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel. Let me stop. Man of God is Elisha. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, saying, beware that you go by not such a place, for there the Syrians are come down. And the king of Israel sent to the place which the man of God told him and warned him of and saved himself there, not once or twice. So this was happening over and over. Therefore the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing. And he called his servants and said, will you not show me which of us is for the king of Israel? Who in the world in here with us is telling the king of Israel everything I say? Somebody is a rat. Somebody is a mole in the camp. Who is it? I want to know. He didn't know. Let me show you what he understood. That's what he understood. Somebody got to be telling them something. There's a bigger world than that. Amen? There's a bigger God than that. Verse 12. One of his servants said, no, my Lord, O king. But Elisha, the prophet in Israel, tells the king of Israel the very words you speak in your bedroom. Are there any men and women of God in the house? You raise your hand if you are. Are there any men and women of God in the house? Guys, this was happening with the Holy Spirit on the outside. What should be happening to a church with the Holy Spirit on the inside? Amen. And he said, go and spy where this man is that I may send and fetch him. And it was told him, saying, he's in Dothan. Therefore sent he horses and chariots and a great host, you might as well say an army, and they came by night and they encompassed the city. And when the servant of Elijah rose early and went forth, behold, a host encompassed the city, both with horses and chariots. Elisha's servant got up that morning to go and get things ready. And the whole city of Dothan was surrounded with the Syrian army. Savvy? This is where Christians start dropping like flies. You understand? This is where Christians start, oh, it's bad. The report is bad. They're looking around, oh, we're going to die. What's going to become of us? We can't make our house payment this week. How are we going to serve God? The report from the doctor says it's bad. The economy is in the tank. What are we going to do? How are we going to send our kids to college? What will we do? Understand, this is what the servant of the man of God said. But let's read on. When the servant of the man of God rose, of course, and he went at the end of that sentence, he says, and his servant said unto him, alas, master, what shall we do? That's the servant speaking to Elisha. Elisha, what are we going to do? Elisha answered, fear not. Would you call that trust? Now, I want you to get out of yourself for a minute. Forget that we're in a church. Forget that somebody's been reading the Bible. And just think for a minute. You find out that tomorrow morning, your house is surrounded. And they're coming for you. What shall we do? Freak out! That's what most Christians would do. You agree? Am I lying? Am I lying? Most Christians freak out if their bank account gets low. Come on. Most Christians freak out if they can't get an auto loan. Most Christians freak out if the doctor says we have to run some more tests. They're already freaking out. What does the man of God say? We shall fear not. We shall fear not. Amen. I love this part. It's my favorite story in the Bible. Elisha prayed. He prayed. I want you to pay specific attention to what he prayed, because he didn't pray your prayer. He didn't pray, Lord, help us, we're dead. He didn't pray us, Lord, help us, we're eating our last food. He didn't speak any kind of negativity over the situation because he didn't believe the pillar would fall. His faith was in a higher place than yours. Come on, seriously. His faith was in a higher place. You know where his faith was? Seated at the right hand of the majesty on high. This is where he lived his life. He didn't live his life here. Oh, he was walking down here, but he didn't live here. He lived with Christ, the King. And let me tell you what he prayed. Are you ready? Lord, I pray that you'll open my servant's eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he was able to see. And behold, the mountain around about was full of horses and chariots of fire. Oh, I could cry because this is my God. And when somebody comes after me, this is the way he sees me because I'm a man of God. Are you a man or woman of God? He does this for one man of God. Would you pray that you could see? We're too busy slobbering and groveling. Lord, help me. He's already helped you. Jesus came. Will you know the truth and believe? The man was not flustered, y'all. Lord, open my servant's eyes that he may see. Behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire. Who are they? The ministering spirits of God. Hebrews says, the Lord said, my servants are a flame. Right? My servants are made of flame, a breath of wind. Chariots and horses, flames. Amen. Surrounded the little Syrian army. Let me tell you how the man of God thinks. The man of God doesn't say, smite them all, kill them, God. Why? Because his faith resides in a higher place. Look at what he said. Verse 18, and when the Syrian army came down to him, Elisha prayed unto the Lord and said, smite this people, I pray you, with blindness. And the Lord smote them with blindness according to the word. Come on. According to the word of Elisha. He wants to honor what you say. He wants you to speak the word of God. He wants you to be his voice on the earth. How many of you remember in Psalm 103, I taught this about 4 weeks ago, Psalm 103 says that the angels, strong and mighty, are waiting to serve, to move at the voice of the word of God. Come on, who is the voice today of the word of God? It's your mouth. They are waiting to move according to the voice of the word of God. Let me tell you, Elisha is the voice of the word of God. Don't kill them. Make them blind so I can lead them the right way. Come on. My enemies, Lord, don't kill them. Make them moldable where I can help them. You see it? And what do you think those armies did? They made them blind according to the voice of the word of God. Elisha's voice. Amen? Y'all, this is in the Old Testament. What do you think God wants to do today? What do you think God wants to do with you? What do you think he wants to do with you? What do you think he's going to do with you? He wants to do this with you. This is who you are. This is your spiritual DNA. You are made of such as this. You were born again for a time. You know, everybody says, oh, let them be for a time such as this, God. That time was 2,000 years ago when Jesus was resurrected. The time is now. The only thing God's waiting on is supposed to be filled with his word, renew the mind, and begin to walk in it. Amen. Elijah said unto this army, they came down looking for him, but they were blind now. They came into the city, and he said, this is not the way, neither is it the city. Follow me. They want to kill him. Follow me. I'll bring you to the man whom you seek. But he led them to Samaria. Y'all, that's the city where the king of Israel lives. He led them right into the place they would not have wanted to go. Certain death. He took them to Washington, D.C. and gave them to the president. So what he did. He led them to Samaria. And it came to pass when they were come into Samaria that Elisha said, Lord, open the eyes of these men that they may see. And the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw, and behold, they were in the midst of Samaria. And the king of Israel said to Elisha when he saw him, my father, what shall I do? Shall I kill them? Shall I kill them? Elijah said, oh, you shall not kill them. Would you kill those whom you've taken captive with the sword and with the bow? Set bread and water before them that they may eat and drink and go to their master. That's kind of odd, isn't it? I'm reminded his ways are not my ways. His ways are higher than my ways. Amen. And they prepared great provision for those soldiers. And when they'd eaten and drunk, he sent them away, and they went to their master. And look what it says. Look what the answer to all this was. So the bands of Syria came no more into the land of Israel. Isn't that what everybody really wanted to start with? We just want Syria to stay over there and quit trying to take over Israel. And if he had killed those soldiers, it would have started a war. Right? God doesn't want you to live in a war. He wants you to occupy your territory in peace. But so many times we don't hearken unto the voice of the Lord and according to his word, and we do things the wrong way. Amen? But look what peace brought. Don't kill them, feed them. Feed them, be good to them, send them home. And any king with any sense said, those are good people, we'll leave them alone. There's plenty of other people we can war against. Amen? There's another story I don't think we have time for. It's the story right after this. I would ask you when you get home, if you have time, read that story. It's even bigger. It's even bigger. These are the kind of things that happened to Elisha. You know, Elisha was the one who came after Elijah. He asked for a double portion of the anointing that Elijah walked in. You realize if you ask God for something like that, he wants to give it to you. He wants his people to walk in a double portion. I'm not talking about so you can have a bigger diamond ring. I'm talking about so that you can exhibit more glory for Jesus Christ, you see. That's what he's interested in. He's interested in men and women that are interested in him. That are willing to take their eye off the pillow and say, show them. Look around about. Give them eyes to see that those that are for us are more than those who are against us. Can you take your faith off of this world and move it up to where Jesus is? Can you take what little you're expecting and lift your gaze up out of this fallen world to where Jesus reigns and believe for what Jesus Christ has for you? If you can, you'll see great things. You will see great things with your eyes if you can do this. Can you live in that? You will glorify your master greatly if you do. He will. Where does your faith reside? I pray you think about this every single day from now till next week. I do. I pray that I think about this every single day from now till next week. Lord, where should my faith reside? I'm just blown away by Ephesians 1:10. And in Christ, in one, he joined all things, both in heaven and on earth. Right now, all things joined. Both in heaven and on earth. That means that all the blessings I've stored in heaven, all the gifts given to me in heaven, the Bible says I've been given every spiritual gift in heaven. And you know what? It's joined right now with everything on earth. There's not a thing out of grasp. It just takes faith. I was long taught that one day when we got to heaven, we could see and experience heavenly things. And I will long now teach that there is no reason to wait for heavenly things because they have been joined through Jesus Christ. That the kingdom of God has come and it's God's will that his will be done on earth now. Amen. greater works. Greater works. Last thing about that, Hebrews 11 is the hall of faith. You know, it's the hall of fame for faith. And if you remember, it says that faith, I believe, I'm going off memory here, it says faith is the substance of things unseen, and our substance of the things we hope for, and the evidence of things unseen. You see that? It's two things. Faith is a substance and it's an evidence. You remember, it's two things. It's a substance and it's an evidence. And we had, and we looked up the Merriam-Webster definition for substance, and it actually said that the substance is the invisible thing or foundation by which things can be manifest or made real. Amen? It's a substance that undergirds that you can't see that brings things into vision. And an evidence, we said, is a testimony. When you're called to the court and you give a testimony, it's evidence. So not only is faith a substance, it's a testimony. I want you to look at Elisha here. When challenged, and the servant, his servant said, "We are certainly doomed. What shall we do?" Let me tell you what he exhibited. He had the substance. He said, "We shall fear not." That's the evidence of the thing hoped for. We shall fear not. That's the evidence. Let me tell you what else it is. Testimony. Fear not. Father, open his eyes that he may see the truth. Does that sound like a testimony to you of what's right and what's real? Do you live your life like that? Is that the pattern of your life? If it's not, change it. Take about a second and a half to make a lifelong decision in your mind to renew it to the Word of God.